Beer first. Beer first.
Right. Beer first. Script second. There we go. All right.
Three, two. It's going to be a 30-second music thingy and then whatever.
Okay.
Hello and welcome to the first ever Fun Shoot podcast. Hi, I am Jong Clemente, and I'm here with the one and only Sarah Hartshorne.
Hi.
Hello, Sarah.
Hello.
So the Fun Shoot podcast is where I bring a variety of image makers and light shapers for unfiltered, straight out of the camera conversations about artistry and entertainment. When thinking about who should be my very first, very special guest, I was very lucky enough to consider a lot of people. So I know a lot of weirdos, so that's good. But only one rose to the top for a couple of very personal reasons. So welcome to Sarah Hartshorne. I'm going to read through a little bit of your bio.
Okay.
And then we'll discuss a little bit more.
Okay.
And you'll see the reason why you're the first very special guest.
And I'm going to blush. Okay. I'm already blushing. Let's do it.
So Sarah is best known as the plus size contestant on Cycle 9 of America's Next Top Model. A very reputable website.
You know, they've
That is no longer with us. Not.com. Voted her as the least annoying contestant of her cycle, I think is the best title that you could get in any reality
TV. Thank you so
show.
Much. I was really proud of that. Yeah. Now defunct.
Now defunct.
R.I.P.
R.I.P. Not.com.
Yeah.
And after the show, she has modeled all over the world with clients like Glamour, Vogue, Skechers, me. I think I'm global from the Philippines.
That's true.
All right. Since retiring from modeling, she's performed stand-up. All over NYC, and all over the world. Mm-hmm. Edinburgh Fringe Festival.
Yep.
That's pretty fun.
Yeah.
30 days of comedy mayhem.
Yeah.
And you're part of the Vagical Mystery Tour.
Yes.
With Lady Parts Justice League.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to talk about that later because that's a pretty amazing production over there that we're going to talk about.
Yeah.
You're a producer.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in your website, you say that your most accomplished, the biggest accomplishment is being retweeted by the one and only J.K. Rowling.
Yeah, I stand by that, honestly. It was a great day. It was a surreal day. I've never, I had to turn off notifications, but yeah, it's a tweet. The tweet's at like 43,000 and that's all that matters, right?
Whatever happens tomorrow.
I can know that the person who wrote Harry Potter was like, hey, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. All right. So before diving into you.
Okay.
This is my show.
Yeah.
It's my first episode. So things are work in progress.
Mm-hmm.
But I had a lot of introspection on what I wanted to be when I grew up. When thinking about passions like photography and this podcast, hanging out with friends and traveling. And then I realized you are the one I wanted to be when I grew up.
Shut up. That's the nicest thing anyone's ever said to me.
So one, you're gorgeous.
Thanks so much.
That's just mom and dad. Thank you. Right?
Thank you.
Right?
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
But you are a successful model.
Oh, God. Thank you. Thank you. I feel there's actually a friend of mine's mom always asks me whenever she sees me, she's like, why do you think you weren't as successful as Ashley Graham or like, you know, any of those other big names? And I'm always like, I don't know, Eve. I don't know what to tell you. Like, I did what I could, you know.
Eve, she's very big, Eve.
She made it. I made a living. That's a, you know, it's 100% an accomplishment.
So you're gorgeous. You're a model. You're a TV star. Not only with America's Next Top Model. All right. But more importantly, you've had a couple of features both in Vice and in Netflix.
That's true. Yes, I did. I did do those things. Yeah, Vice and Netflix. And I don't like to brag, but I did get murdered on a Discovery ID show. So.
Oh, my God. So that's even another feather in the hat of why I wanted to be you when I grew up. Because growing up, I just wanted to be handsome.
Ah,
it's the one thing that you want what you can't get. So it's like, hey, I want to be handsome. Failed in that.
You are very handsome.
Oh my God, yes. Dogs and love me and monkeys.
I feel like I really appreciate you have like tattoos all over your, that to me, like, I don't know. Anyone who just like makes themselves look how they want to look, that that's what I always like. You know, whether it's like hair or facial hair or whatever it is, like I had purple hair until recently, like that to me, I don't know. That's what's always like attractive to me, is someone being like, this is I made myself art.
I am the art.
You are the art.
Yeah. And you're a TV star in ways that I want people to be TV stars. Again, that was right. And not.com was right because you were the least annoying.
Oh, I don't know.
You're still very memorable to the people that watch not only ANTM, but also the tangential reality TV shows around there.
Yeah.
I do have a lot of Bachelor fans that watch ANTM. It's like, oh, you shot that girl from that cycle.
Oh my God, that's so nice. Like,
yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She's even more cool in person.
Oh my gosh.
But the topics in which you were featured in, what do I call them? Films? Short films? Episodes?
Episodes, yeah. Yeah, I guess.
They're the topics that I would want to be an expert at.
I don't know how that happened. I was really excited because, yeah, the Vice thing and the Netflix thing happened like right at the same time. And it was also happening as I was just starting to work for Lady Parts Justice. And it was all about like consent and female orgasm. And I was like, am I a sex talking head now? I feel like I just figured my way around a penis. Like, how is this happening? Like, I mean, I have very strong feelings about the fact that I think that everyone should have a nice, sexy time. But like, I don't know how. Yeah, that was very surreal. But yeah, I've been very proud of that. It's been the past past year, I guess.
Yeah.
And I'm very excited about it.
And it means something. It's, again, you know, consent is one of those things that, you know, people want to think that they ask, want to think that they do, but they do actually really, they really ever think about it. So that's amazing. And it teaches young men and women to be a little bit more smart in the things they stick their thing into.
I hope so. Yeah.
And the female orgasm, very important.
Very important. The pleasure gap is real and significant. And I feel like we've gotten to a place where it's just so hard to talk about because I don't know. It is this one area where men feel powerless, like cis straight men feel powerless. And it's like, I get that, and I understand that that's very frustrating, but like, you kind of just have to nut up and deal with the fact that you are a little bit, sometimes you might be a little bit powerless and a little bit stupid, and you just have to, you know, just ask, just talk to your partner.
It's pretty much like anything in life. If you're bad at it, you can work on it.
Yep.
There are other things that you could do to provide equal or even better amounts of pleasure.
Exactly.
And, you know, if you don't know that you're bad at it, you should.
I know. But, and this is the thing that always gets me is when guys are like, I've never had any complaints. And I'm like, okay, I've never complained. I'm a loud mouthy ass bitch. And I have never complained. I've never told a guy that he was, I would never. Cause what if he murdered me? Oh my God, I could die. Like, I've told one guy like a year later and we were having a conversation about it, about like how this one time that we had sex was bad. We were like, hey, that first time that sucked. That's the closest I've ever come. Pun sincerely not intended, but like that's what drives. I've never had any complaints. They're super satisfied. No, they might not be. Like, I've never, if anyone was going to complain, it would be me. And I never have.
I look at it as, it's like a Yelp review. If it's super good,
yeah,
maybe you'll get.
Maybe.
If it's super bad, maybe. But there's plenty of times that you hate a restaurant or hate a service and you just like, it's too much effort.
And maybe you go back because, you know, it's right
close.
There.
It's close. Close. It delivers. Know. You know, no delivery fee.
Exactly.
So
it's open late, you know.
easily accessible.
This metaphor is on point.
100%. Okay, so... Okay. Successful model.
Thank you.
So amazing jeans. Talking head for the most important things in life.
Thank you.
Which is sexuality and sexual pleasure.
Yeah, I would like to think. That's a good umbrella term because it includes like reproductive rights, you know.
Relationships, you know, a lot of things like that. Yeah. It can tangentially touch it.
Yeah.
But most importantly, you're fucking funny.
Oh, thank you so much.
Well, you are a comedian.
Yes, I am a comedian.
you're gonna have to.
I mean, it's not my bread. Well, actually, I guess, gosh, technically, this is the first year of my life that it is my bread and butter. Being funny is how I have made my living. Man, that's exciting. And new, but yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah, that's there was a Halloween of 2018. I was hosting some friends from Australia.
That's right.
Yeah, and I just don't like they asked me what can we do that is super Brooklyn but not too hipster.
So I said, great question.
Greg, I was like, all right, cool. We're gonna have Ethiopian food. That's cultural. That's like worldly, not necessarily hipster. Mm-hmm. We're going to swing by a heavy metal bar.
Oh, my God.
Lucky 13s at Gowanus.
Okay.
Right? And then we're going
to... Oh, I know that bar.
It's the best. But shout out my friends who dance there all the time.
Oh, my God.
And then we're going to watch a comedy show in Union Hall. And who struts on the stage? Fucking Sarah Hartshorne making me look cool.
Also, shout out. That was, you nailed that. Like, you are an amazing host. That is a very cool night. Like, oh man.
And that wasn't like a real comedy set because you were just telling.
Yeah.
Scary stories.
Yeah. It was a show where we all told our like ghost stories.
Yeah.
And mine's very weird. I don't know if it's a ghost story, but it was like. I lived in a dorm room that was theoretically haunted and did have some very weird things that happened. Dope. Oh my God, that was so fun.
And we had a couple of drinks after, hung out with my friends there. They thought it's like, oh man, you know cool people. It's like, yeah, baby.
You know so many cool people. I feel like that is a trademark thing. Like, yeah, you hang out with all the coolest people. I feel like burlesque, heavy metal, comedy, those are the best scenes in New York, and you got your hands in all of them.
They're also cheap.
This is accurate. Yeah.
So yeah, I tend to go to the cheap and cheerful things.
That's, hey man, that's a good day.
I have a cat to take care of. All right, so basically, I did this podcast because I have a passion. Mm-hmm. I have a hobby. I spend a lot of time and resources trying to be happy, not necessarily good, but happy with photography. Mm-hmm. So I try to frame a lot of the things with photography elements. And what I realized is that my photography made me acquainted with people like yourself. So what I wanted to do is like just talk through most of the time the process in which people do their passions. Minus photography, you have a shit ton.
Yeah.
So you can share whatever you're feeling.
Yeah.
So let's start with, a little bit of like a backdrop. Let's start with a backdrop. Mm-hmm. We're moving furniture around. We're setting up the exposure of the lights and whatnot. So we're doing some test shots and everything. Tell everybody who is listening, the six people that are listening right now, how did you get here? How did you get to ENTM? How did you develop your funny? What made Sarah Hartshorne Sarah Hartshorne?
Well, I do want to say when you asked me to send my favorite picture, I sent one of the professional ones from when I was actively modeling. But if I had to like choose a picture that just felt the most like me, it would be the one that you took of me with the bunny ears and the purple hair with the middle finger. It's just like that. And that was like right after I had like dyed my hair, I'd quit modeling. And that was one of the first shoots where I was like, this is what I want it to look like. Like I felt like I was directing it. I wasn't doing it for an agency. I wasn't doing it for anything other than just looking cool. And I really like, that's one of my favorite photos of myself. And I feel like, I don't know, I always walk away from a shoot with you just feeling like it, like something was captured that I'm just like so happy to show to the world.
I'm crying on the inside. I'm trying to keep it together.
No, I really do. And even like we've shot a bunch, but that one is one of my very favorite pictures. And I mean, I don't know. I really feel like looking back, it's always just been people telling me what to do. Like, I got it. The reason I was on Top Model is a friend of mine was trying out, asked me to come with her, not to try out, just to be supportive. Because mm-hmm. I was a plus size contestant, and I've been like curvy. I have a stand up bit about how I was a plus size model for many years, quit, gained a bunch of weight, and then became a plus size person. Weird how those aren't the same thing. but I've been like curvy since I was 11. So no one, modeling was like not a thing that people really associate. Like nobody ever said like, you should be a model. That just wasn't like a part of my growing up. And so I don't think my friend even really thought of me as like somebody that could end up on the show. But when we got to the front of the line, some PA in Boston was like, oh, you should try out. And I was like, cool, let's go. Let's do this. Like, no hesitation. Like, I want to be the, like, I was like, oh, me? Never. What? No. I couldn't. I was like, yes, bitch, let's do this. Where is the camera? Like, I was like, immediate. The second someone said something, I was like, yeah. And then stand up. So I did the show. And after the show, I thought about dropping out of school and I didn't and I should have. But I went back to school near New York. I'd been going to school in Boston and then I went in New Jersey so I could like commute and try and make it. Couldn't make it happen while I was in school. So I did drop out after a year. And the reason I got into comedy is that it was so circuitous and weird. An amateur wrestler.
Any story that starts with an amateur wrestler.
So this amateur, I say amateur. That's not even fair. He's amazing. He's just not in the WWE.
Okay.
He is like a he is a professional. You know,
The circuit. I'm a big wrestling fan.
Oh, I am.
The circuit is real.
Now, honestly, he would be horrified to learn that I've been friends with him for this long, and I'm only now getting into wrestling. His name's Brimstone. He's amazing.
Oh my god,
he had a roast for his birthday, and it was like me and a bunch of. It was a bunch of like.
Why would you have a roast at your birthday?
Honestly, I don't know. And everyone got shit faced, and like nobody could even get their jokes out because everyone was too drunk. And anyone that wasn't, like, the crowd was too rowdy. It was just ridiculous. But I met this comedian, and I was like, oh yeah, I did stand up in high school, which is true. And he was like, oh, you should do it now. Like, you should do it. And it's just always been people being like, you should do this. And me being like, yes, absolutely. Of course. Like, I just need like the tiniest amount of permission. And then I'm like, yes. But I do. So he said that. And then I started doing comedy. And that was like, that was a long time ago. It took a long time to like he said that. And then it took like a year for me to try an open mic. And then it took a year for me to like do more open mics. And then it took a long time for me to get started. I really only like got started in earnest about 5 or 6 years ago.
And in comedy years, that's not a lot.
That's not a lot.
No, that's not a lot at all.
Yeah. It sounds like a lot, but it's not because the first couple of years you're not really doing shows. You're just doing mics. And yeah. And so that's what I did. And I was still modeling at the same time. And yeah, I was trying to kind of do both. And modeling is really a great day job to have, but it took me a while. Like, because I was also trying to build up the modeling career to be just a career. I had a day job. I worked at a chiropractor's office. I worked selling shoes. I almost starved to death when I was selling shoes. I'm a terrible salesperson. I thought I would be so good. I was like, I'm a great waitress. I'll be a great salesperson. And people would be like, I worked at Lord & Taylor. And they were like, where'd you get your shoes? And I was like, Marshall's. Fuck. No. Here? I got them here?
Yeah. All right. Okay. Sales is not the thing.
It's not the thing.
It's a different thing. People are born salesmen or born not to sell stuff.
Yeah.
Because they're going to sell Marshall stuff at Lord & Taylor.
I just wasn't good. But I think, I don't know. I've always loved comedy. I mean, my cousin is an insanely talented singer and dancer, and she can like play the violin. She was not an idiot savant, but like a child genius.
Yeah. Virtuoso in a lot of things.
Yeah. And I was not. And so we would put on these shows. And when we put on shows, it was always just her being like insanely talented. So the only thing I could do was like MC. And I think that was how it got started. I was just always the person that was like, and bringing to the stage. Like,
that is tip your waitresses.
Yeah.
That is such an amazing way to start things.
Yeah, because I couldn't sing. I couldn't like play it. What was I going to play like chopsticks when she can play like Chopin, you know, like, so yeah, I would wear like a top hat and be the MC at our grandparents' house. And I think that was how somebody was like, oh, you should watch the Carol Burnett show. And then I just I always loved comedy. And I did it in high school, and then I think, I mean, I don't, yeah, when I was modeling, I kind of always like wanted to switch over to comedy gradually.
So comedy has always been there.
Always. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, for sure. I mean, my, yeah, I, my first open mic was at a hardware store in East Hampton, Massachusetts. The Henry Shout out. Open mic. Shout out. Hosted by a country radio VJ. Yeah. Or what, DJ, I guess. Yeah. Radio DJ. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So, I mean, so comedy has always been there. Modeling was both like, it's in your DNA because you are born in a certain aesthetic.
Right.
So that's kind of how both things are about in your orbit.
Yeah.
So, you know, getting a little bit more deep into the process of creating your craft.
Yeah.
You know, what are the things that are similar and different in preparing for, let's say, a shoot versus a set?
Oh, that's, I've actually never even thought of that. I remember when I started modeling, I when I first started doing modeling after the show, I was like, well, I guess I want to be an actor, because mm-hmm. it never really occurred to, this was before I'd met the comedian who was like, you should do mm-hmm. comedy. It never occurred to me that comedy was a thing that I could do, that that was an option. Not because I didn't know female comedians, but I guess I just never put it together for some reason. And I was like, well, I kind of want to be Carol Burnett, so I guess I want to be an actor. So I was like trying to act, and I kept being like, God, modeling and acting are different. Everyone says they're similar, but they're friggin' not. And they just felt so different. And like, I would go to auditions and I would go to castings, and the processes are very similar. You walk in, you get your picture taken, you know, you say your name, you do a turn, and then you know, like at a modeling casting, usually they'll ask you something about yourself, and at an audition, you know, you're reading lines or whatever, mm-hmm. but they always felt very different to me.
What's the funniest thing you said in a modeling casting when they asked you something about yourself?
So they, a lot of times would be like, what's your like, what's an interesting fact about yourself? Yeah. And I always had one that was a go-to, which is, when I was 11, I was in the same talent show as Kurt Vonnegut.
What the
super
what?
Random. It's just a super random tidbit. It's also what I like put on my application to ANTM. It was just like my go-to, like,
okay.
like, Jeopardy story, which is that I was in, and it's true. I was in the talent. He rapped, Kurt Vonnegut rapped with his grandson's band. He rapped Chaucer, which is pretty on brand.
All right. Yeah. All right, I'm gonna say,
And I did nothing, but I was, the only reason I was in the talent show is that my dog sang, and she would get really stressed out.
So basically, the dog was in the talent show.
The dog was in the talent show. Okay. I was literally just there because she would get stressed out if I wasn't, because she was my dog, and my dad would play the violin. Again, I just was like,
the jokes are just writing itself.
I don't
by
even like.
Point.
I just was like, look at the dog, because she would get very anxious if I was backstage, and she would run off stage. So I had to come on stage. And so that was just like always my go-to. And I would just always mm-hmm. say that. And then one casting, I don't know, it had been a long week or something. And I just was like bored. And I just didn't like have it in me to say that story for some reason. And so they were like, you know, what's an interesting fact about yourself? And I was like, oh, my elbow's double jointed. And then I just did it. And it grossed one of the casting directors out so much. Huh. You can see it's like it's double
jointed. Yeah, it is.
It's whatever. It's a double jointed elbow. It does look a little gross, but she was like so grossed out. And I was like, no, 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 it's fine. Like it still works. It's okay. The other one's normal. But the other one like isn't normal. It's like still double jointed. It's just not as double jointed. And so I just was like kind of like
showing them
like going at them with the arm. And she was like, ah. And she was clearly like very squeamish. I'm very squeamish about certain things. Like I related. I was like, it's fine. I get it. It happens. But I think that was just me being like, no, no, like chasing after a woman with my elbow and being like, it's fine. Don't even. I don't know. I had watched Parks and Rec once, and I think I called the bathroom the Wiz Palace.
Dope.
Which is from Parks
that
and
is,
Rec.
That is actually. Oh, I lift so many lines from Parks and Rec.
Yeah. I was like, oh, I don't know. I can't like. I asked someone that I thought was an assistant, like, do I have time to go to the Wiz Palace? And then it turns out they weren't an assistant. They were like one of the casting people. And I was like, hey, I just said Wiz Palace to your face.
Treat yourself.
Treat yourself. Oh. So much. Oh, I mean, I'm obsessed with that.
So show. That's kind of how. So, I mean, I've been shooting a lot of models for a very long time, but I didn't realize that this is kind of like the life. I always thought that you go to a casting and then you submit something and you leave. But now yeah. you have like, yeah, you tell something a little about yourself.
Yeah, you know, you go, you know, and they take pictures. It depends on what it's for, like, because if it's a catalog shoot or something, they probably don't really care. They just look at your picture. But if it's, like, for a commercial or for a campaign or something, they'll ask. And then I think, yeah, I mean, the process is very different because I get very nervous before shoots, before all photo shoots. I always have. And, like... Yeah, and I don't really before getting on stage.
Huh, interesting.
Unless it's big. If it's like an audition show or something, I will get nervous for that. But like the act of getting on stage, like if it's just a show or a mic, I don't get nervous. I get like my heart rate goes up a little bit and I am like excited and I am thinking about what I want to say. Like I have a process, you know, I write out my set list. I don't usually bring it on stage, but I like write it out and I sort of take note about what other comedians have said and like I have a little bit of adrenaline, but it's nothing. It doesn't feel nervous at all. It just sort of feels like, okay, this is like what we're doing. This feels like I'm ready for this. Let's go.
And that set list that you have are jokes that you've worked on, jokes that have been, do you talk to friends and ask them, is this funny?
I used to. I do less now. I used to riff a lot more on stage. I used to riff off of things, and I still riff sometimes. And if I do a little, usually if I'm doing crowd work, I am trying to direct it into a certain bit. You know, like I have certain sort of jokes that I have that like I can segue into from asking someone where they're from. Like it's, you know, they can say wherever. I can riff on that a little bit and then segue that into like a joke. I used to spend a lot of time like asking he was my boyfriend then, but now my husband, being like, is this funny? But now I have you kind of get better instincts, and also you have more resources. Like it's easier for me to just be like, oh, I want to get on a show just to try this shit out. Or I know like this mic is good to test this kind of thing. So I don't need to ask my friends quite so much. Every once in a while, I'll say something and then I'll be like, oh, that might be a bit. And I'll write it down or something, but not very often.
And where do you get the inspiration for all these? I mean, your life is pretty interesting and we've heard weird things about that. You know. So that's material. But
yeah.
If you're running dry.
If I'm running dry, which does happen, getting out of the city helps. Even if it's just, whether it's for a show or not, like, you know, going home or going to Massachusetts or also like I often find I keep a spreadsheet of all my jokes and I have them like divided into like current jokes, old jokes. Well, I have old jokes that could be reworked and then old jokes that I have to let die forever.
See, those are the things that I am excited about talking to people with. Like some people are like, yeah, you know what, I'm gonna do this, you know, and they'll trial and error, whatever. But there are people that, all right, like me, oh, I have an Excel sheet.
Yeah, oh, always.
This worked, this didn't.
Yeah, exactly. I always have to know, yeah, and like just track it. So yeah, I have a spreadsheet of jokes. I have them sorted into like ratings, so it's like clean, like ultra clean, semi clean, and blue.
What's blue?
Blue means dirty, just super dirty. Yeah. Oh, like if you're going to go blue, you're going to go dirty.
Can you give it like I don't want a sample because I know you're keeping your material, but what is under blue? What is a general topic under blue?
I mean, so I personally don't think that my abortion jokes are that dirty. I've never had an abortion, but I talk about having gone on the tour and stuff. I don't think that's dirty, but some people do. Also, yeah, I have a lot about, I used to be, I'm queer, and so I have had sex with men and women, and so most of that material is pretty blue.
That's blue? Not anymore, I'm hoping.
It depends. Like, I have some stuff that's not, like, the opener is just, I used to be gay, and I still am as well, and that's not. But, like, I have a lot about guys' buttholes. and that is blue, I would say.
That, you know.
Yeah.
More power to butt stuff, guys.
But you know,
it's 2019. Do
explore
butt stuff.
Your body.
100%.
Yeah.
That's pretty. You know, I like the process. Thank you for sharing. I'm learning more and more things. It's not just me with an Excel sheet about all my shit.
I'm so relieved.
Before we leave the topic and move to other segments that I've developed for this show.
I'm very excited.
I just want to know, what is the Sarah Hartshorne brand?
Oh.
It's varied. I can't pinpoint. If people are asking me, it's like, oh, you shot that, how's she like?
Yeah.
I guess like, that's usually what I do.
I would say if I had to pick three words, which someone once told me to do, to describe myself, I would say I always want to be, I don't know if I am, but I always want to be funny, honest, and extra.
You know what? I think 33% of each one of those, boom.
Right? Yeah.
Boom. Sarah Hart.
Yeah.
Funny, honest, extra Sarah.
Yeah.
That is you.
That's my goal.
Now we move on to a segment that I like doing here because I am a hobbyist photographer. I most of the people that I will be bringing into the show are people that I've admired or worked with at some point. Mm-hmm. So Sarah did mention that while planning for this recording, I asked her, send me your favorite photo. Send me your favorite image. I was fairly bland. I didn't want to be extremely, I didn't want to steer people on what favorite is or what an image is, so you know, for future people that we're gonna be on the show, it can be of you, taken by you, of somebody else. But Sarah sent us a photo from L'Uomo Vogue, all right, and as her favorite photo, and I'll let you describe it. The link will be on the episode description, so if you're on your phone, just click on it. It'll launch to a link. You can see the photo.
Yeah.
But also, for the ones watching on bit.ly/funshootv or on YouTube, the image is going to splash on your screen right about now. There you go.
That's it.
Yeah.
There's also a video of this shoot somewhere. And it's a picture of me on the cover of this was the Vogue cover that I did. It's Vogue L'Uomo, which means men's Vogue. It's Italian men's Vogue. And it was me and Boz Luhrmann. And I...
Shout out. You know, just Baz.
Yeah. Just
you know, Moulin Rouge. Yeah. Romeo and Juliet. Whatever.
Yeah. And I have like a Marie Antoinette wig, which is mostly my hair, but there are some inserts. And then I'm wearing actual clothes from a museum.
Wow.
Yeah, which I'll talk about a little later because that was the whole thing. And Boz is like kind of leaning on me, he has his hand under my face, and it's very, I don't know, it's very strong but also very tender, and it's, I just really love it. And I love it because this is less true now, but at the time that this photo was taken, it was very hard to find a photo of a woman in a magazine who is standing to her full height and has her mouth closed.
Huh.
They're always like,
wow.
Women were always, and still in
the
a
hanger
lot of,
pose.
Yeah, always are hanging, trying to make themselves look smaller or younger or dumber with their mouth open. And I also, I mean, in this photo, I am significantly taller than Boz, which I am in real life. I am much
slightly
taller. Slightly
frowning,
closed mouth. I look very intense. And I just, in all of the photos, because there was another one that was like the main spread.
Which will also be on the episode description as well as on the website.
Yeah. And I'm like laughing. I'm not standing to my full height because I'm laughing so hard that I'm bending over. And that was real laughter. They were very much creating a scene where all of us were laughing at him, and it was supposed to feel sort of malicious, but he was also being so funny that it was very like, it was just a very fun.
That set. Other photo I also did like very much. Only because it's a, you know, maybe it's a European magazine, maybe it's the Italian men's Vogue, but it's a lot of different looks. There's a curly-haired young guy.
Oh, my God, who was, like, 13 years old.
Oh, my God.
He was so young.
Look, and you have this, like, black dude with a top hat with mm-hmm. a lady with see-through fishnet
yeah.
Shirt on there. There's a face-painted guy.
Oh, yeah, with tattoos. Those are real tattoos.
Real tattoos.
Yeah, he has tattoos all over his face. He has maybe since died.
Oh, my God.
I might be confusing him with someone else. I'm not sure.
Rip, if ever.
Yeah.
You have a African-American lady or a black lady.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, my God. Seems to be super tall, too. Short
super
hair.
Super stunning. Yeah, almost shaved head. Mm-hmm. And she's from, I think, I want to say Sudan, and she's beautiful. Yeah. And yeah, her skin just like glowed.
And there's an old dude in the back that looks like Blue from Old School, which I really appreciate.
Yeah.
Oh, man, boy, Blue.
That's true. Yeah.
So this is an amazing photo, of course, because it is from a premiere magazine.
Yeah.
And probably taken by a very, very extremely experienced photographer.
Yeah. It was, I know this, I should know
Rushka,
this.
I'm going to let you.
Or possibly Francesco Carrozzini. I think he was the art director.
Okay.
And the photographer was also, I don't know how to say his name. I'm going to find it. But yeah, it was amazing because that set was Rushka Bergman, I think, was the photographer. Mm. And then Francesca was the artistic director. It was, yeah, everyone was at the top of their game. The stylist was the best stylist mm-hmm. in the world. The photographer, like down to, you know, the photographer's assistants, like everyone was just so good. And I was the only plus size girl. It was me and two other models. And then the woman that's in the fishnet, outfit in the main spread, not on the cover. It's just me and Boz on the cover, but in the main spread, there's a woman with her fishnet outfit. She was a contortionist.
Dope.
And she was like one of the most famous contortionists in the world. You know, like
they cut off her face.
I know, it sucks. And
but I guess it's
and the, also yeah, in the cover photo they cut out a bunch of people. That originally was not just the two of us.
I got it.
Oh no, wait, that's not true. I'm sorry. I'm lying. Someone got cut out of the another person got cut out
cut
of the
in
spread.
The spread.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah, yeah. The cover was originally just us, and it was so flattering because it had been like a very weird, rough morning. First of all, I found out about the booking like maybe a day and a half before it happened. I just got a call from this casting office and they said, hey, can you do Vogue on Tuesday? And I was like,
sure.
Yeah, I think I can find time in my schedule for that. So I went to the studio and it was like on.
Was this shot in New York or?
Yeah.
Did you have, okay.
No, I was in New York and I walked in and it was like the fanciest set I'd ever been on with this huge fancy food spread. And they were like, you know, just grab some breakfast, whatever. We're running a little behind because I was also early because I was so insanely nervous that I was like.
It is, you know, it's just Vogue.
It's
just
Vogue.
You know, whatever.
So I grab some food. I have like, you know, the stylist comes and grabs me and she goes, thank you so much for being early. Let's go up to costume. So I go up to costume and then she looks at me and she goes, did you bring bacon to the costume room? And I was like.
No.
May I have some?
And I just tried to like hide and she was like, oh my God. So then she was like, you know, we had to get special clothes in to fit you. Because
wow.
I had to like send all my measurements. And she was like, we had to get special clothes in from a museum to fit you. Because all the other girls were wearing like couture and they had to get these weird ass clothes from a museum to fit my fat ass, which is, you know.
Is insane to me. Because looking at the cover and you keep on saying, like even watching or like YouTubing a bit of the episodes from Cycle 9 mm-hmm. of America's Next Top Model, keep on saying plus size model. In my brain, that is not plus size.
I mean, and the thing is like I get on some level certain parts of fashion require very thin women. Certain parts don't.
No.
So the fact that it's so exclusive makes no sense. Right? Like the cover, I think that we did, it wouldn't have mattered what size I was.
It doesn't.
I could have been the size I am now. I'm a little bit bigger than I was then. I could have been the size, you know, I could have been a size 2. It doesn't matter. Like designer runways, you do need a thin woman mm-hmm. because you have to have something that you need a coat hanger, basically.
Exactly.
You need to throw something on them and know that it will look good. That is also becoming less true now as they get celebrity model, as like celebrity social media presence becomes more important.
But even the criteria of plus size modeling now is, you know, I think they need to not to use a pun, but tighten it up a little bit, because, you know, they're, you know, this photo is definitely not plus. Like,
right.
Whatever you look like, it's like, no, this is, you seem like a coat hanger model.
Yeah.
But there are actual plus size articles of clothing, mm-hmm. The Lane Bryants and stuff like that. Okay, so that's actual
right.
plus. Like, that's actual bigger sized women.
Well, and
you can see.
When I was a plus size model, I don't think I modeled for Lane Bryant, but I did model for some plus size brands mm-hmm. that started at sizes bigger. Like, I couldn't shop in their stores. Mm. I would like walk into their stores to take a picture of myself in the catalog or on the walls, and they would be like, can we help you? Like, we don't have any. And I would be like, I know you don't have anything for you, but I'm on your freaking wall, yeah. you know, like, and now I'm a little bit bigger. And like I said, I have a joke about how I'm now a plus size person, and like I can, but it was just always crazy to me that, yeah, they would hire me to model their clothes, but like I couldn't go shop in their stores. But this shoot. So she was, yeah, so she had this, like, I don't know, 200-year-old skirt, which I stepped in and immediately ripped the lining. Immediately just, like, stepped in it and shredded it because it was 200 years old and, like, my toe touched it and it immediately shredded. It was fine. Like, it was just the lining. But I was like, oh, cool. This has been in a museum and survived 200 years and
beats
me for 30 seconds. But it was also just, it was a rough morning, you know? And I was like, oh, my God, I'm fucking up. Like, I'm fucking this up. Like, I am just ruining it. And then to, like, kind of get singled out by Boz and by the photographer and to be like, we want this image mm-hmm. for the cover. Like, your face. They were like, your face is very expressive. We really love, like, the connection you have with the camera. And so they chose me to, like, have the sort of the special, like, shoot for the cover. And I was really excited. And then I was just also really excited that, yeah, they didn't ask me to make myself smaller or like, yeah, just look sort of any less like scary and crazy and intimidating than I did. To be fair, they had done a lot of work to make me look that scary and crazy. You know, like
you
the
do
makeup.
Have that Victorian makeup.
Yeah.
That
oh, I have like
covered your eyebrows.
Yeah.
You have that little tiny lip. Lipstick.
And then they put on the fake mole and the hair. Like they had, you know, they were going for a look, but I was just very excited. It just felt very like empowering. And I should have, quit then, man. That's a high.
I'm done.
Yeah.
But you didn't, but
no, I didn't.
We're glad that you didn't quit that quickly.
No.
But you know, settle it for, you know, for those, dumb people out there, photographers and other, non-model people, you worked hard on this shoot.
I did, yeah. And I got paid very little.
And the question that even I guiltily have had when I started photography is like, you're a model. You were born pretty.
Yeah.
You just stand around, do a couple of how hard can it be? But tell people how hard it can be.
That's fair. There is a lot of that. And it's one of those things, any job is hard if you want to be good at it. This is the thing. Like, and I think that includes modeling, but there are great parts of it. You know, you do get to travel, and like that's great. But there is a lot more behind, right? Like you have to, even as a plus size model, so you have to stay the same size, mm-hmm. You know, and you can't fluctuate in weight very much. And if you do, it's a big deal. You have to redo all your test shoots. You have to update your comp cards. You often have to buy new comp cards, and that costs money, which they'll take out of your checks. You know, so like, okay, so before this shoot, I had a day. Almost dropped my phone. I had a day and a half for this shoot. So fine, you shave your legs, you shave your armpits, you get a bikini wax. You know, you do a body scrub, you do a face mask. That's all sort of pretty standard. Sometimes, you know, by the time this shoot came around, I was a full-time model, so I didn't have to call out from work. But a lot of people, you know, it's not their only gig, so you have to call out from work. And
that's true.
And then, yeah, you know, the shoot started at, I want to say, 7 a.m. At the time, I was commuting, so I took a train, which is also why I was so early, because I was so paranoid that something would happen with the trains. And then, yeah, you know, we worked all day. And the crazy thing is I had been making a living off of catalog shoots. So I was used to getting paid like a lot. Not like I didn't make that much per year, but every shoot, like I would make $1,000 a day. And And I got paid like $200 for this. Wow. And it was, you know, we started.
Is it because they threw you the Vogue?
Yeah, well, high fashion doesn't pay as much as catalog. I think because, to be fair, no catalog shoot involved this many people. Like, there were so, you know, there were three makeup artists and there were like a bunch, you know, the stylist and all of the, you know, most catalog shoots have
there
like
was a museum in there too.
There was a they like got the museum pieces from somewhere. Baz and his whole crew. Like, it was, there were so many people on set. So it costs more, but yeah, you also make way less. High fashion, you make way less than like catalog. The reason models do high fashion is that they hope that if they do high fashion, they'll get a campaign. And if you get a campaign, that's like, that'll can be the only thing you do for a year.
Nice.
You know, you get like tens of thousands of dollars, sometimes millions. It depends on how famous you are.
And the experience with Baz was fun?
It was really fun. He was very nice. He got an oxygen facial. They did an oxygen facial on him in the morning. And then he looked too young. Like, he looked very weird on camera. And so they had to put on makeup to age him, which was really funny. Because, and I saw the photos and I was like, yeah, it looked like a kid that they had hired
with
to
a
wear
beard.
A beard to play Baz Luhrmann. It was like very surreal. And his wife was like very creeped out by it, which was really funny. And his wife does, I think, all of the like costumes and set designs. Either the costumes or the set designs. I'm not sure. So she was there. And she was really nice. It was great. Yeah, it really was just like everyone at the top of their game, like working very, very hard, yeah, it was amazing. And I was like, can I have that oxygen facial? Because no one knows who I am. I can look like a child.
Well, the both the shots will be shared, and I hope people will look at it. It is a work of art. You know, there's a lot of magazine cover shots out there that are very generic and very easy to do. Even somebody who's not super great, can do those. But this is one of those.
Absolutely do those.
But this one is like, yeah, the expressions. Even I feel that the people picking the shots for this cover and spread had their work cut out for them. And that's the thing that you always want to do in a shoot.
Yeah.
So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah.
Thank you for the background. People will now learn more about how these things are made.
Yeah.
But something that I didn't or I won't be doing when I'm asking my very special guests to come over is I also picked my favorite shot of you.
Yay!
And then we can discuss who is it from, where is it from.
Okay. My gosh, this is so exciting.
Right, so I'm going to flip my iPad so Sarah can see, but you know, people in the audience can see, and then click the link if you want to see it.
I love this picture. So this is it's just a headshot that I had after. So when I quit modeling, so after the Vogue shoot, I was like, this is amazing. And I had this moment because I had been actually planning on quitting. I had been planning on quitting on this certain birthday. And I was like,
main reason. I mean, I'm sure there's a million, but you know,
no, there was really just, there are a million little ones, but the biggest one was that I assumed that at a certain point I would age out of modeling and I would have to figure something else out. But I realized someone told me, I met this woman who was a catalog model and she was in her 40s and she was like, you know, you can keep doing this indefinitely. Like, there's work for catalog model. And I was like, oh no, I could get stuck as a model and not have any life skills and not have any impetus to like go do what I really want to do. I never thought of modeling as a thing that you could get stuck doing. I always assumed it would either provide the opportunities to do other things that I wanted to, or that it would force me eventually to do. And I was like, oh, that's not true. I have to, if I want to do comedy and I want to make funny content that I like, I have to make myself do that.
That is actually super smart, because most people look at these glamorous jobs as the end goal.
Yeah.
And it needs to be the start. It needs to be that, hey, I'm going to be on TV for 2 seasons or a season of a something reality, whatever.
Yeah.
After that, I'm going to ride the wave. But that wave is not going to last too long.
Yeah.
And then I'm going to do X.
And if that wave isn't going to carry you into whatever you wanted to do, because like I saw a lot, right? Like I saw models that were carrying it into what they wanted, whether it was, I saw girls, you know, from Top Model who parlayed it into designing clothes or accessories, or parlayed it into speaking engagements or whatever it was. And I was like, this is not going to parlay into comedy. It's just not going to happen. That it's not a right. Like I can talk about it.
Are there no like scene for the comedic models out there?
Not the way that I wanted, you know what I mean? And I was like, maybe there were certain things that I could have done, but I just was like, oh, if I want to do what I want to do, I have to like make. So I was like, all right, I set myself a cutoff date. I worked really hard. I booked as many commercials as I could, because that's really where the money is, so that I could work for free for a year and just learn how to be on a set and produce stuff and be a producer. And then I was like, I'm going to quit on this birthday. So the Vogue shoot was after I had decided. I didn't exactly know when, but I was like, I want to quit. And then after that happened, I was like, I don't know. Maybe I should stay. Like, maybe I'm going to be really successful now.
There's
like,
another Vogue coming up.
I don't know. And then
Baz might cast me in the next Romeo and Juliet 2.
Yeah. And so I was like, oh, okay. I wasn't sure. And so I stayed in it. Still, I was like, that birthday is still going to be my cutoff, but I want to just like explore what this is going to happen, what this can make happen for me. And then I did a shoot, where I was shooting plus size costumes in a warehouse in New Jersey. And I got into a fight with the photographer because I was wearing a geisha costume and I wouldn't do more Asian poses. And I almost got fired. I was like, this is a great lesson in walking away when you're on top. And I didn't, and that's okay. Take this money.
Did you ever see those costumes?
I sure did.
I think I saw a couple of, you posted a couple, but I never saw the geisha one, I think.
I posted that one on Twitter. I don't know if I posted it on Instagram.
We're going to find that out.
But it was humbling. It's real humbling. Because also just like, you know, if I had seen what I looked like with the best team in the world, like making me look crazy and amazing, I now, you know, the makeup artist was great. Mm-hmm. I will say the makeup artist was amazing. I looked great. The Photoshop was less than amazing. and also I was wearing like a slutty cops outfit and like a slutty Virgin Mary outfit. You know what I mean? It was what it was. I'm grateful for the money. I absolutely put it in my savings, you know, it was what it was, but I was like, okay,
we're good.
I'm back on track. I'm going to quit when I said I was going to quit. And I told my agent, I was like, look, on this day, I'm dyeing my hair blue. And that's going to be it for me. So I did it. I dyed my hair blue, and that was my first headshot. The picture that you showed, it was shot by Theik Smith.
Oh, Theik.
Yep.
Yeah, Bronx dude.
Yep, who's amazing. It was the first. I mean, I think it was like the day after I dyed my hair, I was just like drunk off of change, you know, like just I was like, oh my god, like I did it, this is happening.
Shout out Theik, you know, like
Theik is amazing.
I've seen his work. He does a lot of really clean stuff that I try to do as well, so I peek at his work so I don't copy it too much. It's like I want to be slightly different than how he does things, but
I feel like you guys are, I see the similarities, it is very clean, but he is more like dancer. He's like ballet dancers, like almost fitness muscle, and I feel like you're much more glamorous, like I don't know, not less realistic, but like, yeah, glamour. Like to me it's like your light is more I say flattering, I just mean like beautifying, whereas his is like a lot of it is like his headshots, I'm like, okay, that's what I look like on the street. Mm-hmm. You're what I want to look like on the street. You know what I mean? When I'm like, let's do it. Like,
I love that photo because in having shot you a few times now, having seen a variety of your work, I think from the things that I've seen on your model mayhem account, your IG, your website, and Facebook, that was most representative of how all of it has become, like, you know, long hair, favorite color is blue, showcasing the thing that I always look at in my subjects. It's the face. I love shooting. I respect the figure. When I shoot people, they're just a bunch of lines and shapes. But something that cuts through everything of that is, no matter how big, small, sexy, flabby you are, the face is the face.
And yeah, and that really, I think that really shows in your work, because like there's a shot of me where you can see my butt and I'm like holding balloons, but the light on my face is like, I'm obsessed with this shot. It's a shot that you, I'm trying to think if I, I must have posted it to my Instagram, but it's a million years old. But that is also one of my favorite shots of me. Is a shot you took, because
I'm crying inside.
No, and my husband was like, right, that's really what you look like. And I was like, oh my God, is that like, because I was like, that's definitely not what I look like. Like, my butt does not look like that. Like, I had to work. I had to arch and like pinch and like suck and like tooch and do all the things. And he was like, no, 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 your face. Like, that is. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh my God, you know what?
That's probably the best thing I've heard, because that's what I try to do for people who are going to review the portraits in my portfolio or in my IG for a very, very, very long time. All I did was semi-dark portraits, because that's all one I wanted and all I'm capable of doing. It's like, I don't want to set up all these lights that you're seeing lighting Sarah right now. And the reason is, like, everybody is prettier when it's more them than what they're trying to act out. So I feel a lot of burlesque people that I shoot with, yeah, we'll do three sets.
Yeah.
To your costume, one, you're just going to fucking stare at the lens and that's it. There's not going to be a lot of fancy stuff in there. So I'm glad that, you know, people like you, real professionals and artists do appreciate this.
Oh, 100%.
And, you know, again, you know where I live. You're going to be here whenever you're bored and whatnot. But yeah, so we've gone through pretty much everything. You've gone through your stories, and, you know, I am very appreciative about everything that you have shared, but also just who you are.
Thank you.
Because that is pretty cool. And, you know, even now, an hour into the conversation, I was not wrong in picking you as the person I want to grow up with.
Oh my gosh.
I'm never going to be a comedian.
Don't do it. It's terrible.
It's hard to, you know, it's hard to just be out there and, you know, things that you feel are funny might not be funny.
Yeah.
And it might be funny here, but not funny there. I don't like that. I don't like that. No. I don't like the confusion.
No, it's terrible. Yeah.
But before we head out,
yeah.
I really did want to put at the last segment of the episode is your work with Lady Parts Justice.
Yeah.
Because it's a combination of both something that I really like, comedy, but also it means something.
Yeah.
So just, you know, tell the people out there how you got involved, what it is, and, you know, maybe where they can catch you.
Yeah, absolutely. So I am a writer for Lady Parts Justice League. There's two organizations. We're also changing our name to make it extra confusing. but if you search for Lady Parts Justice, you will find us. And even after we change our name, we're changing our name because we want to be more inclusive, because we named ourselves Lady Parts Justice after this very specific thing that happened in the news many years ago. And now the news moves much faster than it used to, and so things that happened a couple years ago don't matter anymore. So we want to be more inclusive of trans people and understand that, you know, a uterus is not actually a lady part. But what we do is we do comedy shows, we create comedy content, we make videos, and just do whatever we can to raise awareness about reproductive justice and about access to abortion. And then we also provide support on the ground to independent abortion clinics, because independent abortion clinics provide about 65% of the nation's abortions.
And they're closing at a very, very high rate.
And they're closing at an insanely high rate. They're targeted by politicians on a state level and at a national level. But that tends to get a lot of attention, right? Everyone paid attention to Kavanaugh. We're all very nervous about that, and that does suck. But the fact is that state senators and state legislators have been eroding rights on that level and closing clinics for a long time. And so they've been in danger for a while. So, yeah, we have the Vagical Mystery Tour, which you mentioned, where we will go into a city like Wichita or Jackson, Mississippi, And we'll visit the clinic, see what they need. And then we have a comedy show, which we tend to sell out because there are really strong, powerful, amazing liberal bubbles in these areas.
100%.
And they will come out for this type of show. Wow. And maybe they don't know, you know, what their clinic needs. Maybe, you know, and so a lot of times it'll just be like, hey, they can't find a plumber because the last plumber they had got doxxed by antis. When we were in Nebraska, they had a contractor in. And the anti-choice people that protested outside, they posted all of his info on the website. Wow. And they posted where his kids went to school. And so he felt really bad, but he's like, I can't work for you anymore. Mm-hmm. And so there was someone who was like, hey, I don't have kids. I can fix your fence. You know?
That's awesome.
And so he went and he fixed his fence. And so, we just do that kind of thing to just raise awareness. And then we write videos. We have big award shows. We do all kinds of things. Oh. It's been really amazing. And that was one of the first sort of big jobs that I had coming out of modeling. And then it's grown sort of since there. I went on tour with them and I worked on some shoots with them. And then eventually, they just hired me as a writer. And they're amazing. It's great. We have a show, which is the first Wednesday of every month at Eastville Comedy Club. And... it's the first Wednesday. We will this summer, our schedule is going to get moved around a little bit, but if you follow us on social media, it's Lady P Justice. We'll be posting when it is. And we're also hopefully moving venues soon. Oh. So yeah.
But Eastville not good enough for you?
Eastville is amazing. Yeah. We might be moving to Union Hall.
Oh my God. Okay. Take that back. Eastville is great.
Eastville is amazing.
Support them still.
Absolutely.
But Union Hall is way closer to my apartment. So I'm going to be there a lot then.
Yeah.
But that's amazing. It's something that I have seen. Unfortunately, I have not gone, but it has been in my docket to visit because it is not too far, at least for me.
Yeah.
Anybody who wants to support this amazing, amazing cause. Again, it's like nobody's trying to be extremely political or nobody's trying to like bash an idea in your head. But if somebody told you that you have zero choice or you have less choice than what you had yesterday, that will affect any angle. Doesn't matter if you're red, blue, white, yellow. So
exactly.
The idea is, you know, fight for your choice, fight by your vote, with your vote, with your dollars, support causes like this, plus also just have a fucking good time.
Right? I mean 100%.
How amazing is that? You're supporting a good cause and you're having a great time.
Yeah, so follow them, follow me. I post their stuff all the time. I'm Sarah B. Hartshorne on Instagram, and then they're Lady P Justice or LPJL League. There's two organizations, which is very confusing, but it's really just so that we can lobby.
100%.
Which you have to be a specific.
All of the links will be on the show descriptions.
Yay.
Please click, follow, subscribe, visit them. Sarah, thank you so much for your time and your energy. I am not only entertained, but inspired by everything that you've done.
Thank you so much.
Before we head out, is there any other things that you want to plug? Upcoming shows, where is your regular bar that you
just follow me and I'll be posting it, because I hope I have a lot of exciting stuff coming up, and I'll be traveling a lot outside of New York, but also in New York. So just follow me on Instagram or Twitter. It's Sarah B. Hartshorne on Instagram and Sarah Hartshorne on Twitter, and I'll post all the things.
Bah, 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 bah. Again, thank you, Sarah, and thank you, listener, for being with us. This is the Fun Shoot Podcast. We will have new episodes dropping most Wednesdays on all your favorite podcasting services around the globe. If you're listening through iTunes, Apple Podcast, I would love it if you'd subscribe, rate, and review. It will greatly help the future of this content.
Mm-hmm.
You can visit the podcast at bit.ly/funshoot or johnclemente.com/funshoot. If you don't like listening to shit and you like watching videos at work and you have YouTube and it's not blocked by your VPN, you can go to bit.ly/funshoottv and, you know, see the episode there.
Yeah.
And listen to us.
I made some gestures, you know, that can't really be captured.
100%. So. You can see the double jointed elbows in life. Please follow and comment on the podcast Twitter and Instagram account at Fun Shoot Podcast. We'll have a lot of updates there, some teasers for future episodes. And you can interact with me so that we can ask follow-up questions to our guests or future guests if you have topics that you want us to discuss.
Yeah. Oh, my God. Ask questions.
100%. Yeah. And send us your comments and questions if you want it by actual writing. FunShootPodcast@gmail.com. Please, we also encourage you to participate. If you want, you can leave a voicemail at 347-934-9594, and we will feature that content or your voicemail at an appropriate time. So if it's if there's an episode coming up with that particular topic, we'll put that there. If it's very inappropriate, I'm just going to listen to it by myself in my room. Again, thank you very much for listening. Sarah, thank you very much.
Thank you.
And have a good day, guys.